Mark chapter 15. Very early in the morning, the chief priests with the elders, the teachers of the law, and the whole Sanhedrin made their plans. So they bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. "Are you the king of the Jews?" asked Pilate. "You have said so," Jesus replied. The chief priests accused him of many things. So again Pilate asked him, "Aren't you going to answer? See how many things they are accusing you of." But Jesus still made no reply, and Pilate was amazed. Now it was the custom of the festival to release a prisoner whom the people requested. A man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder in the uprising. The crowd came up and asked Pilate to do for them what he usually did. "Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" asked Pilate, knowing it was out of self-interest that the chief priests had handed Jesus over to him. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to get Pilate to release Barabbas instead. "What shall I do then with the one you call the king of the Jews?" Pilate asked them. "Crucify him," they shouted. "Why? What crime has he committed?" asked Pilate. But they shouted all the louder, "Crucify him." Wanting to satisfy the crowd, Pilate released Barabbas to them. He had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified.
That he should give his only son.
The soldiers led Jesus away into the palace, that is, the praetorium, and called together the whole company of soldiers. They put a purple robe on him, then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on him. And they began to call out to him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" Again and again they struck him on the head with a staff and spat on him. Falling on their knees, they paid homage to him. And when they had mocked him, they took off the purple robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. A certain man from Cyrene, Simon, the father of Alexander and Rufus, was passing by on his way in from the country, and they forced him to carry the cross. They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. Then they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him. Dividing up his clothes, they cast lots to see what each would get. It was 9 in the morning when they crucified him. The written notice of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." They crucified 2 rebels with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "So, you who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, come down from the cross and save yourself." In the same way, the chief priests and the teachers of the law mocked him among themselves. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. Let this Messiah, this King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we may see and believe." Those crucified with him also heaped insults on him.
This darkness, there's light. Your cross is shining, so people open your eyes. The cross stands above it all, burning bright in this life. The cross towers over it all. One hope, one deliverer. Life.
At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 PM. And at 3 PM, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing near heard this, they said, "Listen, he's calling Elijah." Someone ran, filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down," he said. With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion, who stood there in front of Jesus, saw how he died, he said, "Surely this man was the Son of God." Some women were watching from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James the younger and of Joseph, and Salome. In Galilee these women had followed him and cared for his needs. Many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem were also there. It was preparation day, that is, the day before the Sabbath. So as evening approached, Joseph of Arimathea, a prominent member of the council who was himself waiting for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. Pilate was surprised to hear that he was already dead. Summoning the centurion, he asked him if Jesus had already died. When he learned from the centurion that it was so, he gave the body to Joseph. So Joseph bought some linen cloth, took down the body, wrapped it in the linen, and placed it in a tomb cut out of rock. Then he rolled a stone against the entrance of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of Joseph saw where he was laid.
Thank you. Hello there, and welcome to our Good Friday morning service. So this last week we've seen Jesus entering into the city of Jerusalem with jubilant scenes, with crowds cheering, palms being waved, jackets being lowered onto the ground as Jesus entered. But sadly, the week was not to end like that for Jesus. This was Jesus's final week, the culmination of his mission, and events that happened this week are now etched in history. And Trevor said, I can choose whatever gospel I want to follow Good Friday. So instead of choosing one, we're actually going to follow all four, as the gospels on this occasion come closer together and they say pretty much the same thing, with one or two things added. So as I say, we've reached Good Friday and it's the early hours of the morning. The Sanhedrin have been in a meeting all night, one of those all-nighters that the deacons very rarely see. They've been seeking witnesses to testify against Jesus. Now, according to the Jewish law of evidence, they need at least two witnesses with the same testimony before taking the case towards Pilate. Now, you can imagine they've been meeting all week. So they've probably interviewed, 30, 40, maybe even 50 people. And after all this, they find just two witnesses, just the two they need. They actually, though, misrepresented what Jesus had said. Jesus said that he would destroy the temple of God, referring to the one in Jerusalem, and rebuild it in 3 days on his own. That was their testimony, not quite what Jesus said. Now, to speak out against the temple is blasphemous. This was one point that Caiaphas needed. So then Caiaphas asked Jesus to defend himself. Jesus remained silent. And then Caiaphas asked Jesus, under an oath, in the name of God, to tell the council if he was the Christ, the Son of God. And this, his response is recorded in Matthew 26, and he says, you have said so, but I say to all of you, from now on you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven. That was enough. Enough for Caiaphas, enough for the Sanhedrin. But as the Sanhedrin couldn't actually execute Jesus themselves, they handed over Jesus to Pilate to be tried and found guilty. It's at this point that the Gospels on today all say the same thing. After the meeting with the Sanhedrin, Jesus is handed over to Pilate. Now, following on from those verses, the four Gospels then talk about being before Pilate, and it's noted in John that the priests themselves did not enter the praetorium where Pilate was, as they did not want to defile themselves so that they could eat of the Passover. So Pilate graciously came out to them to see what all the fuss was. What charges are you bringing against this man? Charges were related. After many questions between Jesus and Pilate, Pilate finds Jesus without any guilt. Not just once, not just twice, but three times. Now by this time, an angry mob had appeared outside the Praetorium. And Pilate remembered it's customary at the time of Passover to release a prisoner. The priests had been busy whipping up the crowd into a fury to support Barabbas. And despite Pilate's wife's warnings in Matthew's gospel that he should have nothing to do with this, and despite the shouts of those brave enough to shout for Jesus, Pilate was swayed by the sheer volume of noise from those in the crowd shouting, "Free Barabbas! Free Barabbas!" So Jesus was handed over, and those immortal words, "What shall we do with him? Crucify him," they said. "Crucify him." Jesus is then led away, crowned with thorns, mocked and beaten. Now is the time for Jesus to be led through the streets, carrying his cross through the narrow streets of Jerusalem. Now you can just imagine, just as Palm Sunday, the streets were lined with people, but they weren't cheering like they cheered that day. Many were hurling insults at him. They were jeering at him. Some turned their face away. Jesus, staggered by the weight of the cross on his shoulders, and only here Mark and Luke mention about Simon of Cyrene, who was entering the city at the time, perhaps to go to the temple where he worshipped, and he had been forced at that time to carry the cross for Jesus. Jesus carried that cross all the way up the hill to Golgotha, the place of the skull. And it was there that Jesus was crucified along with two others, thieves, rebels, commoners. He was offered wine mixed with bitter herbs. This was used like a morphine, like a painkiller when pain gets too much these days. And then above him, an inscription written in Hebrew, Latin and Greek, saying, "This is Jesus, King of the Jews." This naturally incensed the priests, and they wanted it changed. They demanded it be changed, but they were refused. Whilst all this was happening, more mocking was going on. A crowd had gathered and were hurling insults at Jesus, taunting him to save himself by coming down from the cross. Even one of those crucified with him, as the last hurtful remark, mocked him, telling him to save himself. until he was rebuked by the other. And then at the feet of Jesus, almost oblivious to the goings on, were the Roman soldiers. They didn't care what was going on, just a job for them. They were dividing the garments of Jesus between them, except that he's just one, a seamless undergarment for which they cast lots. Then the sixth hour came, and there was darkness over the land until about the ninth hour. Now in our terms, that's about noon till 3 p.m. Jesus speaks on the cross for a fourth time. This time, there's more anguish in his voice. Eloi, Olei, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? Again, Jesus spoke, I thirst. That's in John's Gospel. More wine was offered on a reed. And then the final words of Jesus, it is finished. Again recorded in John, but in Luke, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Now with the death of Jesus came, when that came, the veil of the temple was torn in two. Matthew's gospel alone says the earth quaked and the rocks were split. Tombs were opened and the bodies of many saints were raised. Then in Matthew, Mark and Luke, an affirmation from an unlikely source that truly this was the Son of God. The crowds had all but dispersed, leaving just a few acquaintances to witness all these events. And as it was now the day of preparation, and soon the Sabbath was about to begin, the Jews asked Pilate to break the legs of those being crucified so that they could be taken down and got ready. But when they came to Jesus, they saw that he was already dead, so they did not break his leg. Instead, they pierced him with a spear. It was then Joseph of Arimathea went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus so that he might be buried. They wrapped his body in a shroud and that was brought by Joseph, and they laid him down in his tomb. A large stone was rolled over the entrance, and they went and rested as the Sabbath was close by. So Good Friday has drawn to a close. You and I, we both know what happened. We all know what happened days later. But the people we've encountered today in the Gospels didn't know what was going to happen. Though Jesus had told his disciples many, many times this was going to happen and what was going to happen, it's as if their ears were closed to what was going to happen, to what Jesus was actually saying. Now the chief priests kind in you, hence a Roman guard was placed at Jesus' tomb. But I don't think anyone knew for certain. For those who followed Christ, it was a dark time. Their master, their rabbi, their mentor, even friend, had just been executed in the most vicious and cruel manner. We call this Good Friday. But for them, it was far from good. What I want you to think about now is that I wonder how you would react if this was the first time for you. We've spoken about different people groups. We haven't mentioned Judas. I haven't mentioned Peter and what happened to those two. But here you are, witnessing the arrest, the trial, and the death of someone you followed. Maybe you followed him for the whole of his ministry. Or maybe you just followed him since he arrived at Jerusalem, caught up in the euphoria of that Palm Sunday. He was someone you listened to, with your heart on fire at the very words that he spoke. Put yourself somewhere in the scene. Try to imagine what you are seeing, what you are feeling. Just remember, you don't know what's to come in 2 days' time. Let's pray. Father God, we lift your word to you, and these scenes that we have witnessed and looked at today, Lord, it is hard to imagine what it would have been like for those disciples, for those followers of Jesus, as they see their rabbi being crucified, not understanding what Jesus was telling them, that on the third day he would rise again. Lord, may we see that crucifixion for the first time. May we see, Lord, with new eyes. Lord, we ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
So rich a crown.
my heart.